You get that, you've got it all. Do you understand that? Yeah, Father, I thank you. I thank you for your word. I thank you that we can praise and worship you. I thank you that you literally come onto the scene in every area of our lives, and I thank you. Father, I ask you now, and we receive it for your wisdom, your revelation. We ask for the knowledge of you. We ask for the eyes of our understanding to be opened, to be enlightened, so that we will know what is the hope of your calling, what is the riches of your glory, what is our inheritance as your saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of your power toward us who believe according to the working of your mighty power, which you wrought in Christ when you raised him from the dead and you seated him at your own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principalities and powers and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. Daddy, thank you for putting all things under Jesus' feet, for giving Jesus to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body. And we are the fullness of him that filleth all in all. Do you agree? Yes. Well, did you ever see such good-looking kids? You all have to look at these outfits when you're just sweet. God is good. Right back to our little ones back there. God is good. Is he good? These songs just get to me. What we're going to do this morning, you can be seated. We're going to play a video, a DVD, from Bill Winston. Okay, this will hype you a little bit. You know, the reason I like Andrew Womack, I like a lot of them, is because he just keeps it simple. He explains it, puts it out there. But once in a while, a little hype doesn't hurt anybody, does it? Right? Okay, so it's rising to the top. When you asked Jesus into your heart, you rose to the top and you're seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Now, when you listen to this, know who you are in Christ. You are his child. You are on the same level as Jesus, because if you're seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, then you are on the same level. Do you agree? You've already got it. And then when we finish, we're going to take communion. We're not going to serve it right away, though. We're just going to take a minute to get a better understanding. Can we do that? So now, with Mark 10:29-30, and Jesus answered and said, "Verily I say unto you, there is no man that hath left house or brethren or sisters, or father, or mother, or wife, or children, or lands for my sake and the gospel's. But he shall receive 100-fold now in this time, houses, and brethren, and sisters, and mothers, and children, and lands, with persecution, and in the world, what comes? We have eternal life. But persecution is going to come. Sicknesses and things are going to come. But you have no part of that. You are redeemed from the curse. So let's play that, please. Rising to the top. And take some good notes because it is delicious.
From today, you're no longer to be pitied. You're to be envied. And what God is going to bring to the blessing in your life is equivalent to the Garden of Eden.
Glory to God.
And it's so much till you can't hide it anymore.
Hello, I'm Bill Winston, and welcome to another program. The program that you're watching is called The Believer's Walk of Faith, where we walk by faith and not by sight. Well, today's teaching is entitled Rising to the Top. Now, this is where God wants us. In other words, he said to Abraham that Abraham would be famous and distinguished. He said he's going to put him above all nations. I'm talking about we're the seed of Abraham. And God said he's going to make us the head and not the tail, the lender, not the bar, above only and not beneath. Now, here are a couple of points I want you to remember about this particular teaching. If your condition isn't lining up with the word, more than likely, the enemy is stealing from you. Because he is a thief. He comes to steal, kill, and to destroy. Now, when you get the blessing in your life, the blessing is designed to eradicate the curse. It's designed to bring deliverance in every area of your life. Now, what do you have to do? You have to take that blessing and confess that word and then expect God to move on that word. That blessing goes into operation. The next thing you know, things are reversed in your life. Things that you've been struggling with have now turned into the Garden of Eden. Praise God. Well, number two, God wants us out of debt because he has promised that his people would be the lender and not the borrower. Now, here's a message translation, and it's found in Deuteronomy chapter 15. Here's what it says. Watch this. All debts are canceled. God said so. Once we come into the kingdom, the debts are paid. Jesus paid it all. See? So all debts are canceled. You now can receive your debts canceled. I'm talking about supernaturally. I mean, let's just believe by the end of the year, your debts will be canceled. Well, wait, I got a mortgage debt, Pastor. Ah, doesn't make any difference. Mortgage, auto, school loans. Oh, all debts are canceled. Did you hear what I said? God said so. Get your Bible. Let's go into it. It's called Rising to the Top. If you belong to Christ, then are you Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Are you Abraham's seed?
Yes.
Are you an heir?
Yes.
What he spoke to Abraham, is that for you?
Yes.
How are you going to receive it?
By faith.
Now, that means you get up in the morning, say, Father, I thank you for the blessing that is on my life. Now, why am I saying this? Because that same blessing now is passed on to Isaac. So it says over in Genesis chapter 26 and verse 2, he says, talking about Isaac's life, and the Lord appeared to him and said, go not down to Egypt, dwell in the land that I shall tell you of, and sojourn in this land, and I'll be with you. Sojourn means walk around in it like you own it. Well, I will bless you, for unto thee and to thy seed will I give all these countries, and I'll perform the oath which I swear to Abraham thy father.
Amen.
And then he says, and I will make thy seed to multiply as the stars of heaven, and I'll give unto thy seed all these countries, and in thy seed shall all nations of the earth be what? Blessed. So he's not just going to bless this group. Who is he going to bless? All the nations. Now, he's not just going to bless this group of people here. He's going to bless who again?
All.
Now, who does all the nations of the earth include?
Yes.
That includes you.
Yes.
Black folks, white folks, Indian folks, come on, Chinese folks, any folks that folks, they're going to get the same blessing. So, notice verse 12 in that same chapter. Then Isaac sowed in that land and received in the same year 100-fold. And who blessed him? The Lord blessed him. And the man waxed great and went forward and grew until he became very great. And for he had possessions of flocks, possessions of herds, great store of servants, and the Philistines envied him. You were never supposed to be pitied. You were supposed to be envied. Now, I want to show you something, because when the blessing starts coming on you, you can't hide it. You cannot hide the blessing. Why? It's going to overrun anything you've got. Now, what I said to you in terms of six steps to the top, don't confuse or mistaken your condition with your portion. If what you read doesn't agree with your life, you coming up short. I'm saying the devil is stealing something. And the first place he's stealing it is through lack of knowledge. And I'm telling you, I'm giving you the knowledge. I'm giving you the knowledge so that you can wake up in the morning and say, I'm blessed. I'm blessed going in to work this morning, and I'm blessed coming out to work. You take that scripture. Why? Because you got to believe what you say.
Now look at this. Let's look at a New Living Translation. Again, look at this. And when Isaac planted his crop that year, he harvested 100 times more grain than he planted. For the Lord, what? Bless him. Now, we're not talking about increase over time. We're talking about explosive increase. Shindarabahaya. We're talking about increase that happens overnight.
Yes, sir.
Are you following what I'm saying? Now, it would be not good if God increased you, ran all that stuff over, and then the devil took your life. So one thing you know, not only do you get the prosperity, but you get the protection with it. No, you're not to be pitied. You're to be envied. The time for y'all getting secondhand stuff is over.
Amen.
Come on, come on. You gotta stay with me now. Cause see y'all looking at me strange now. I don't know about this. Don't try to take the word of God and bring it down to your thinking. You take your lifestyle and take it up to the word of God. Got it? Think about it. If you knew everything, you wouldn't be in here. And if your life and condition in your life does not match the word of God, you got some work to do. It's not that God is holding it back from you. It's something you don't know and something the devil has stolen.
Yes, sir.
This is your inheritance. Go get it. All right, now, I want to show you something in here, because where Jacob got blessed, I want to go back there to Genesis again, chapter 27. And Isaac began to tremble uncontrollably and said, "Then who just served me with wild game? I have already eaten it, and I blessed him just before you came in. And yes, that blessing must stand." Now watch this. I got my Bible at home, my New Living Bible or Old Living Bible at home. Here's what it says. "And I blessed him with an irrevocable blessing." So once you are blessed, you can't wash it off. Once you are blessed, Satan can't separate you from it. Once you are blessed, the only way it doesn't work is that somehow you have been talked into doing things that are anti-blessing. Things that will cause that blessing not to work. Hatred won't work. Come on now. Anger doesn't work. Are you following what I'm saying? I'm saying you, as you rise, anybody that's going to rise with a blessing is going to be persecuted. In fact, he said over in Mark chapter 10 and verse 29 and 30, when you receive the blessing of a hundredfold, he said, and Jesus answered and said, "Verily I say unto you, there is no man that has left house or brother and sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my sake in the Gospels, but he shall receive a hundredfold now in this time, houses, brother and sisters, mother, children, and lands with persecution." You're guaranteed to be persecuted. Now, if you're guaranteed to be persecuted, how are you going to handle it? With love. See, if you retaliate with it, it will cut off the blessing for your life. What you've accumulated could be stolen. And not only that, you won't make it to the top.
Amen. All right.
So make up your mind right now that you ain't going to get mad, hang, start hating on people, and so forth and so on. Make up your mind right now. Come on now. Now, see, in the natural, those kingdom principles seem to be weak when they come up against principles like revenge and manipulation. No, they're not weak. You see, hatred is a slow death. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 14 and verse 12, "There is a way that seems right unto a man, but the end of that way is death." Your body and mine were not made to hate. You can even get strife in your body and in your mind, and you'll find that strife and anger and hatred, it even affects the bones. It said it will rot your bones. Why? Because it's from the pit of hell. And I'm saying, get it out of your life and make up your mind. Well, they make me mad. Well, you better find some other way to vent it, because if you vent it other than love and start letting a lot of mess come out of your mouth, that anointing will stop. That thing will stop. See, and the next thing you know, stuff that you got start drying up, and you wonder what happened to you. Get your attitude back right. All right, let's look at it. Come on over here to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 5. Is this the right bunch I'm talking to? Now, you saying, wait a minute now. For some reason, I think I deserve to hate. You know, you don't know what they did to me, Pastor. I deserve. No. You can't play that kind of game. You can't. You in the kingdom now. Say amen. Amen. You are going to represent your Father. Yes. And he said one thing: vengeance is mine, and I will recompense. Yes. Folks, he just told you, whoever tried to curse you, going to be cursed. Yes. All this is yours. Yes. Say, it's my inheritance. It's my inheritance. Everything that he did for Abraham, everything that he did for Isaac, everything that he did for Jacob, he has to do for you.
Amen.
So the blessing is your only guarantee that you will reach your destiny.
Amen.
That this blessing that is on your life guarantees that you'll finish your assignment.
Amen.
Remember, you're not supposed to be pitied. It's supposed to be envied. Matter of fact, look at that on a scripture. Look at what it says in Deuteronomy chapter 28 and verses 1 and 2. Let's look at that first. Deuteronomy 28. And it shall come to pass, if thou hearken diligently to the voice of the Lord thy God to observe to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee high above all nations of the earth. Go all the way down to verse 10, please. And all these blessings shall come on you and overtake you. Verse 10. And all the people of the earth shall what? See. Say see.
See.
Folks, you can't hide it.
Amen. Amen.
You can't hide it. You think they like you and all of that. But wait till you drive up there in that Bentley. You think, come on now. Come on. Wait, come on. Wait till you show up with this Boaz.
Yeah.
How does she get him? She don't even look as good as I do. See, this blessing will go to work for you. From today, you're no longer to be pitied. You're to be envied. And what God is going to bring through the blessing in your life is equivalent to the Garden of Eden. Glory to God.
Glory to God.
And it's so much till you can't hide it anymore.
Amen. Glory to God.
Man, I'm preaching better than you saying anymore. Now, what happened? Do you believe that?
Yes.
See, if you just believe your man of God,
yes, sir,
and start confessing it and walking in it,
yes, sir,
and expecting it,
yes, sir,
it will work on your life. Now, what can you do with it? You can change the culture of a community. Glory to God.
Yes, yes.
Of a whole city.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
See, Adam had it on him to manage the universe.
Yeah.
The power of that blessing. It was, let me just read you a couple of people, because it's going to take you from the bottom to the top. Say, the bottom to the top. Say, I'm going from the bottom to the top. And it's starting today in the name of Jesus. So I saw some things here. And I saw Job's life. Job had lost everything. Am I right about it? God in Genesis, in Job chapter 42, restored Job twice-fold what he had before. How about Joseph? Joseph was in jail. Am I right about it? Did he not get raised up out of jail and became prime minister? Am I right about that? Joseph made Pharaoh the richest man in the world. Pharaoh had a lot of political power, but he didn't have all the wealth. But Joseph got all the wealth. How about Jacob? Jacob, look what it says in Genesis chapter 32 and verse 10. This is Jacob's life now. Jacob, look what he says, his life. He said, I am not worthy of the least of all the mercies and of all the truth which thou hast shown unto thy servant. For with my staff I pass over this Jordan, and now am become two bands. Let me give you my translation. I left home with a stick, and now I have become two armies. How about Ruth? You know where Ruth was found. Ruth was found in the field with her mother-in-law, poor, with nothing, and gleaning. What is gleaning? Gleaning is where the rich people leave some vegetables around the fields, around the out perimeter of the field, and the people who are poor just go in and pick some beans for themselves, kind of sharecropping, if you will. And that's where she was. But all of a sudden, a man rolled up, and a man on a big white horse rolled up. Say, who is this damsel here? And they said, oh, you don't want to know her. She's a poor woman, and so forth. He said, no. I like that sister. Come on, sister girl. Who are you? Come on now. And Ruth ended up marrying the richest man in the county. Come on, Ruth. There's some Ruth is up in here. How about Esther? Esther, you know who she was. She was an orphan. I mean, her mother and father had passed, and her uncle took her in. Folks, that's just another mouth to feed. But her uncle had vision. He had understanding of a blessing. He had it so much until he wouldn't even bow down to wicked Haman. And so what happened? Esther, he got Esther in the palace, and the next thing you know, Esther got favor, and the next thing you know, Esther saved a whole nation from being exterminated. Saying, I got some Esthers up in here. Now, how about Mary? Mary was somebody you never heard of, but one day an angel came and said, Hail Mary. Say Hail Mary three times. No, don't you do it. Don't do it. And he said, Hail Mary, thou art highly favored among women. He said, Blessed art thou among women. What happened? This woman who never seen a man became fruitful. And I'm telling you right now, you might be past the age of childbearing, and you said, I'm getting married, and you said, well, I'm past the age now. Don't count the blessing out, because the blessing will reverse the curse. The blessing will put you back so you walking like a young lady again. And I'm saying now, what about Jesus? Jesus was in that grave. He was counted out, but one day God said, get up. Up and became the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Give God a shout. You are blessed in Jesus' name. Come on, give him a shout. Receive the blessing. That's it. Receive the blessing. Receive the blessing. Glory to God. Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo. Glory to God. Glory to God. Say this with me. I am blessed of the Lord. The blessing of Abraham is on my life. From this day, I will confess the blessing. I will activate the blessing. And it's coming out of of Deuteronomy 15, verse 1. And in Deuteronomy 15, verse 1, he says, at the end of every 7 years, thou shalt make a release. And this is the manner of the release. Every creditor that lendeth aught unto his neighbor shall release it, and he shall not exact it of his neighbor or of his brother, because it is called the Lord's release. Now look at that in the Message translation, and it says this in the Message translation. It says, at the end of every seventh year, cancel all debts. And then it says, it is the procedure. Everyone who has lent money to his neighbor, write it off. And you must not press your neighbor or his brothers for payment. All debts are canceled. God said so. One more time. All debts are canceled. God said so. Now, over there, somebody said, well, Pastor, that's 7 years. Well, look what it says here in Mark chapter 7 and verse 24. This is a woman who came to Jesus for healing. And from thence he arose, and he went into the borders of Tyre and Sidon, and entered into a house, and he would have no man to know it, but he could not be hid. For a certain woman whose young daughter had an unclean spirit heard of him, and he came and fell at his feet. And the woman was a Greek, say a Greek, a Syrophoenician by nation, and she besought him that he would cast forth the devil out of her daughter. And Jesus said to her, let the children first be filled, for it is not meet for you to take the children's bread and to cast it to dogs. But she answered and said unto him, yes, Lord, yet the dogs under the table eat the crumbs, children's crumbs. And he said unto her, for this saying, go thy way, the devil is gone out of your daughter. Now, see, in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, Paul says, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believe. To the Jew first, to the Jew first, to the Jew first, to the Jew first, then to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live how? By faith. So you're going to live by faith. Now notice, this Syrophoenician Greek woman, she came to Jesus, but it wasn't her time. He's coming for the Jew first. It ain't your time, lady. Lady, stop bothering me. It's not your time. But she pressed in by faith, because faith moves time. Anytime you come in faith, your 7 years are going to become today. So I said, all debts are canceled. God says so. You receive it by faith, and your debts are going to be canceled starting today. Now give God a shout.
Amen. Glory, 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 glory. God is good.
All the time.
I play this because we go through the death, the resurrection, but do we go through what we've received? This is what we've received. We rise to the top. We all know about Jesus dying. Okay, we all know being scourged. We all know that, don't we? Know he went into hell, and after 3 days, he rose up out of hell with the victory for us. But let's go a little bit further. We're going to talk about commitment. You're not going to put it down for a minute. Okay, because otherwise we're fuddling with the communion cups and stuff like that, and we're not going to do that. We're going to do communion, and we're going to give our tithes and offerings. But what I want to bring to you this morning, now listen to this. This is about Jesus. This is about Jesus. Jesus answered, I told you, but you don't believe. Everything I have done has been authorized by my Father. So everything that you just heard has been authorized by the Father. See, when we don't live up to those standards, then we're living the world's ways instead of God's ways. Then we're not seated in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Actions that speak louder than words. You don't believe because you're not my sheep. Oh, my sheep recognize my voice. So we're acting like we're not his sheep because we don't believe what he says. But we need to believe what this word says. This was all the word. This is rising to the top. When you got born again, you rose to the top. I know them, and they follow me, Jesus said. I give them real and eternal life. They are protected from the destroyer for good. We are protected from the enemy for good. No one can steal them out of my hand. The only one that was stolen out of his hand was who? Judas. Did Judas ever receive him? No. Once you receive him, it is finished. Go back and look at what the scripture says. You already have it. He covers it all. Who you are is a righteousness, even though you mess up royally, right? The Father who put them under my care is so much greater than the destroyer and the thief. No one could ever get them away from him. I and my Father are one heart and mind. So Jesus only did what the Father showed him and told him what to do. And he did it in total rest. He went to the cross, total rest. He was crucified on that cross, total rest. When he went into hell, it wasn't total rest, was it? Because the Holy Spirit had to leave him. He had to be separated from his Father. And so he went and he suffered a horrible death. But what for? Listen to this. 1 Corinthians, now we're talking about communion here, okay? 1 Corinthians 11:30 says, "For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep." What is this talking about? He's talking about communion. He's talking about what do we have? What do we have? What do you have? Are you supposed to be rich?
Amen.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Are you supposed to be rich?
Yes.
Are you supposed to be healed?
Yes.
Are you supposed to be debt free?
Yes.
You heard it all. We've got to take the word of God and make that first place in our hearts, right? Now, 1 Corinthians 11:29 says, this is the New King James Version, "For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body." So in 1 Corinthians 1:30, it says, and this is the King James, "But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God has made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption." He has made unto us. He made us free from sickness, disease. He's made us debt free. He has made us whole. But because we're not rising to the top, we settle for less than the best. We want to sit and be stroked. We don't want to work at anything. Hey, guys, just think, in the natural, we work so hard at trying to fix something when we see it go wrong. I'll say, for instance, doctors are very good. We know that. We know that. But do you know, you can go to a doctor, you can go and you can have surgery, but when it's a spiritual thing, which sin is, you cannot be healed. So many people are sickly and die because they do not discern the Lord's body. They're not listening to what the word is saying. He's saying you have to take the communion. You have to separate, and we do that here. We separate the bread from the cup, right?
Yes.
You've got the bread and the cup. We separate it because they're both for separate things, true? I want to go on to this a little bit. We drink judgment to ourselves, not discerning. Get that into you. God does not want us to be condemned with the world. See, the world is condemned. We know what is going on in our government, but I will promise you right now, because the Word of God says it, everything is going to be all right.
Amen.
Everything is going to be all right. It's a promise from God. So when the devil comes at you, whatever situation, if it's sickness, finances, whatever it is, God said, if you take my word, if you take my word, you will turn it around, and the devil will have to divvy up. He'll have to return it to you, just like he had to return to Jesus when Jesus went into hell and the Holy Spirit came back into Jesus, what did Jesus do? He said, give me what you stole from Adam and Eve. Give it. And he had to. He didn't have a choice. He was the ruler. And he rose up out of hell and he gave us the keys of the kingdom. He gave us everything. He gave us healing. He gave us prosperity. He gave us. But you know, we worry more about money than we do about what God's word is saying. We consciously think more about ourselves than we think about the word of God. So let's put aside the money. Oh, but Pastor, no, you're serving manna. You're judging yourself already. Jesus Christ was already judged and he paid for everything. He already made you wealthy, right? Boy, you look at some of the people he was saying. You look at Ruth. Wow, she was broke. Horrible situation, right? Gleaning in the fields. She was a bum. But Boaz came along, a type of Christ, and redeemed her, one of the richest women around. Esther, how many nations, 26 provinces that she saved because what happened? This orphan girl that got adopted rose to the top. That's talking about us. Look at Jacob. Two nations come out of him. We've got to remember what we have. You're not just a poor old sinner. No. When you're saved, you're not a sinner anymore. God has already, through Jesus Christ, judged that sin. Yes. He's already judged that sin that you just committed. Yep. Right?
Yep.
Yeah. Do you have to repent? Well, you know, when you open the door to the devil, you have to tell him to get out. That's repenting. That's turning it around. No, get out in the name of Jesus. Sickness comes on you. Don't say it's because I sinned. No, don't do that. Don't bring condemnation on yourself. For there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, right? So now, sickness is going to come. But the devil's trying to get you conscious that it's your fault. You did it. You didn't eat right. You didn't exercise enough. Yeah, we have to eat right. We have to exercise. Otherwise, we're going to, right? This body was made to live forever. But what happens? We start to consciously believe the devil instead of consciously believing what God has given to us through Jesus Christ. So now, there was a divine sentence that was put on Adam and Eve when they sinned. That divine sentence was the curse. Then God gave us a way out through Jesus Christ, through taking communion. Remember, I've spoke to you already to take communion. I'm too excited, aren't I? I got to settle down a little bit. Jesus Christ gave us a way out. We can take communion every day, all day long if you want to take communion. Well, Pastor Jan, you know, I did that and that didn't make any difference to me. No, you don't have enough information to realize what an awesome thing it is. When you take communion, what are you doing? You are literally saying, Jesus, that stripe that you took on your back was for what? For that cancer. That stripe you took on your back was for my debt. That stripe you took on your back was for whatever. Sore knees. That stripe you took on your back. The sentence that Adam and Eve had was death, sickness. But the sentence, Jesus Christ judged it already. He judged it. How did he judge it? By taking it into hell, and he paid the price for it. It is finished. See, we've got to get that, don't we? So, you know, anybody that you heard that, and I've said this before already, people curse you. People come against God's kids. They're in so much trouble. Anybody comes up, you just turn around, you cut that curse off, because the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. And when you speak the word of God over that situation, you cut it off. Amen. Remember with my kidney again?
Yep.
Had a big old tumor in there. squashed down to a barbell. When the doctor did the surgery, he said, it's just impossible. It wasn't connected to anything in the kidney. It was just there. The night before, Mylon and Marguerite, I remember their name, came up to the hospital and prayed over me. They knew more of the word than I did. I hardly knew these people. They came up and they said, can we pray for you? Sure. When they prayed, I did not realize it, but that thing got cut off. No damage to the kidney. No, they didn't have to cut it and do this fixing. There was no damage. The kidney didn't have to be taken out. It was severed because of the Word of God. Do we have that? The Word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. It will go and do what it was sent to do, and it'll not come back to us void. So see God as judging the sin, judging poverty, judging sickness, any disease. I was having problems with sinuses and things. I'm like, what is this? By the stripe on Jesus' back, I judged that was taken to hell with Jesus. Did you get it? It's a curse. Do the curses belong to you? Should we run from the devil? Why are we running from the devil? Why are we running? Hey, this morning I stepped out in front and I'm looking over my flowers and stuff like that, and they're coming up. The tulips, they're not, but the, what do they call those other things? No, I got different stuff coming up. The one with all the little flowers on, they smell hyacinths and so on. And the little yellow ones with the little buttercup and little purple ones are coming up, and I just look at them, they're beautiful. Was that set that way a long time ago? That was made a long time ago. They're perennials, they come up every year. I just look and say, oh, you're so beautiful. Do you know, God's already taken care of everything for us. He's given us the seed of his word. We planted in this perfect soil of our hearts, because when we said, Jesus, come into our heart, Jaden, we got brand new soil. That soil before wasn't good. That soil before wasn't good. Now that I'm born again, that soil is perfect soil. So I've got the perfect word, perfect seed, which is the word of God, right? Do you have the perfect seed?
Yeah.
So you speak that, and that goes down into the soil of your heart. And will it grow?
Yes.
How in the world can you have a tumor in a kidney and it's not connected? He just stood at the end of that bed. The doctor just can't figure out, wasn't connected to anything. And the surgery was supposed to take a long time. I told you, 12 inches the cut is from there. It was supposed to take a long time. It took a lesser amount of time. Why? He says, because you were so skinny. You didn't have to go through all the fat. God is so good. Why don't we take him and believe him? There are so many testimonies. I wanna have him bring that up. Would you, Keegan? Bring up this little boy. This is John Rufus. And this little boy had a stroke, or the symptoms of a stroke. Symptoms of a stroke. And he's 8 years old. Look at that. 8 years old. That's the way his face was. All right. He couldn't eat, he couldn't do a lot, but he wouldn't go to school because he was so embarrassed. Can you only imagine? Now hold it right there. Then his family, who is Christian, realized, hey, we can take communion. We can commune with God, and we could take this deformant, which is a stripe on Jesus' back, and we can have a divine exchange. The divine exchange was from that. Now give me the next picture. 8 years, there. 15 days. 15 days. How can that be? Look at that. Go back to the other picture again, please. Look at that. How would you like to have that be your kid? Now, I'm going to tell you something. I never expected Pastor Kenny to have a stroke. I never expected to have problems with a kidney and have to. I never expected a lot of these things. We didn't expect for our son-in-law to have a heart attack. But we do know that the only thing that cut off that tumor in my kidney was the Word of God. We know the only thing, the only reason Pastor Kenny is alive and also our son-in-law is alive, because of the Word. No doctor can fix any of those things in the natural. Amen. That's why when something happens, we've got the Word of God, Michaela. Something's wrong? Cut it off. Amen. Don't take it. Amen. No, I'm not going to take this. Mm-hmm. When they said a defibrillator, am I saying that right? Yeah. Or a pacemaker for Kyle? Nope. Tracy's on the other side. I said, no, we don't receive that. That's the Word of God. We did not receive that because only 43 years old, he's 43 now. He doesn't need that. 53. No. Why are we settling for stuff? Oh, we'll just this, we'll just that. No. You got to be a fighter. You have to know what belongs to you, and then you have to take what belongs to you. Do you understand that? Now, that little boy, do you think that was a spirit, a satanic spirit that came on that little boy? How many of you parents, you don't want anything like that for you? No. Look at your children. Look at these beautiful, oh, goodness, one is prettier than the other, aren't they? You don't want that to happen to your children. But if it would, what would you do about it? What would you do about it? Take communion and exchange it. That was the reason for communion, is to realize that this is from the curse, and Jesus already paid the price for the curse. So are we redeemed from the curse?
Amen.
We're redeemed, meaning we are set free. Now, when we take communion, we take the bread. We take that bread, and that bread says, by the stripes of Jesus, you were healed. By the stripes of Jesus, you were set free from poverty. By the stripes of Jesus, anybody does you wrong, you are restored. But what happens? We fall into a pit. We fall into a pit, and you can't get out. Remember the old donkey going along, fell into the pit? Came along, can't get the donkey out. You know what? Remember the whole story? Okay, the donkey falls into the pit. People can't get the donkey out. So the people said, well, he's just making so much noise. Let's just throw dirt on him and cover him up. Bury him alive. That's what they try to do to Jesus. That's what they try to do to some of us. That's what the devil tries to do. But what happened? Every time another shovel full of dirt went, the donkey stepped up. The donkey stepped up. He got higher and higher until he walked right out of there. That's you. That little boy, 15 days. And now look at the picture. Next one. Look at that. Because they knew the way out. You see, we as born-again Christians, as child of the King, we have a way out. And that is through communion, remembering what Jesus Christ did. If they would have stopped communion and stopped believing at 11 days, 10 days, 14 days. Remember old Naaman went into the Jordan? I don't want to go in that dirty old river. He was, they should treat me better than this. I want the Elijah to come out here, or somebody to come out here and treat me with respect. No, go dip yourself in the Jordan. Finally, he's like, oh, I'm in such poor shape. He went, all over him, sores. He went into the Jordan, and on the sixth dip, he went down. The seventh, he went down, and he raised up. The seventh, it was all gone. Isn't that amazing what God has for us? But we have to. We have to forget about ourselves and stop looking at the problem and stop thinking about ourselves and think about what Jesus Christ did on that cross. Remember, they beat him and they beat him and they beat him again. That was for us. Why didn't they take him? They take him and just run him right into hell and forget about the cross? Because the cross, he had to take those stripes for us. He had to take those for us. What do I mean? He took stripe cancer. Oh, I see my body has cancer. Oh, wait a minute. That stripe, now see that stripe going cancer, going on Jesus, and now seeing yourself whole. See yourself whole. I'm healed. You start taking communion day after day. I don't care how many times you take it in one day. Debt, do the same thing. Take communion. I've been redeemed from that debt. Debt is under the curse. I don't want that anymore. So every stripe that fell on his back, every stripe that fell on his back, you know what I'm working on all the time? Something. All the time. But the more you learn, the more you think, I've already got it. So now, when that stripe fell on his back, your sleeplessness and insomnia disappeared because he had that. By that stripe, whatever your condition is, you say it. Whatever that condition is, landed on Jesus' back. Got it? I think you, by your stripes, I thank you that by your stripes, I thank. Now, I don't think, I thank. See what I'm doing? Don't get confused. Thank him for what he's already done, because it's already done for you. Why aren't you taking the benefits? Remember, Mike was here. And he talked about, if you had $1 million in your account, would you be living in a ratty-tat house with no indoor toilet and stuff? No, you wouldn't. How about if you're a billionaire? What kind of house would you be living in? But we look at ourselves instead of looking at the one who has supplied all of our needs, right? And then we say, oh no, look at my check, look at my income, look at my outgo, I just can't seem to make it. You see, what we've done is we have judged ourselves as what? In poverty. Now we're to judge ourselves in prosperity, because he took everything on his back and he redeemed us from the curse. So, what you want to do is you want to be thankful to the God. If you've got a heart condition, by the stripe, look at it happening on Jesus' back. You've seen a lot of movies. Heart attack is on the back. Heart condition is on his back. By his stripes, I'm healed. Be grateful. By your stripe, Jesus, I am healed. My brain is healed. By your stripe, my memory is healed. My faculties are healed. By your stripe, I am healed in my ankle joints, in my knee joints. By your stripe, I am healed. Repeat that. Take communion, and realize that you are already healed. You're already healed. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to take communion now. Now, we'll pass it out. Because I didn't want you messing with the elements, but I want you to get this here now, that when you take that bread, that was his body, and you look at that bread as taking the stripes of that disease, sickness, or poverty, whatever it is, talk to him personally. You have a personal relationship with him, don't you? Absolutely. Take that personal relationship and take it to the bank. Do you understand? Amen. God is good.
All the time.
God is good.
All the time.
Amen. God is good. He is so good. So now, you want to judge yourself. What does that mean? That means judge that Jesus Christ already took the curse. Jesus Christ already took the sickness. Jesus Christ already took every problem. What problem do you have? What concerns do you have? Jesus Christ took it on him. It's finished. Does that make sense? Amen. There is no curse. There's no curse. There is no curse on you unless you allow it. And we allow it because we judge ourselves that we are under condemnation. We're not under condemnation. We are not under condemnation. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Are you with me?
Yeah.
The condemnation went on to Jesus. It is finished. He took care of it all.
Amen.
So you look at that now. What is going on in your life? See the stripes going on Jesus' back. Cancer just went on his back. Depression just went on his back. Problems with pornography just went on his back. Problems with drugs just went on his back. Homosexuality just went on his back. Poverty just went on his back. It all went on Jesus. You are free. Say, I am free.
I am free.
Now, you can do that every day as many times as you want. Hey, when I'm in the car and I don't have the elements, I see it happening. I see it happening. I see it happening. Do you understand that? Then let's eat. So we just partake of not the death sentence that Adam brought on, but the life, healing, prosperity. That's the sentence you have now on you. You no longer have. You no longer have it. And you know what? If you're taking communion, you say, I just don't see anything happen. Don't get all worried about it. Remember David? David, he was like to God, oh, your mercies are great every morning. And he was just having a horrible time. But then suddenly... Okay, but don't go out telling everybody about your problems, because then you're focusing on the problems. Focus on what God did through Jesus Christ at the cross.
Amen.
Focus on what Jesus Christ did. Focus on what he did. Focus. Anything's wrong, make it right with the Word of God. His Word, it's already finished. Is that awesome? When you think about it, it's so easy. But why is it so hard? Because there is an enemy, he is called Satan, that he is constantly pelting your mind with doubt. And then you get a pain in your body. And fear comes. And fear, what is the acronym for fear? False evidence appearing real. You say, get off of me. But do you start believing? You get a bill in the mail and you say, there's no way I can pay this. Don't do that. Don't do that. This was something that Mike Hesh said too. You go and you get your car. Something happens with your car and you take it in and they say, it's $2,000 to fix it. Stop! Oh, I can't afford that. And you run around like a chicken with your head cut off. And then finally you say, wait a minute. Father, I'm going to get another opinion. And you go someplace else and they say, oh, that's only $500. Feels much better, doesn't it? Do you see? Don't look at what the devil tells you. Look at what God is showing you. How many times had you had something, maybe a water heater, maybe wash machine, or I don't care what it is, and you're like, oh, I'm going to have to do this. And then you find out it's something so simple, maybe just a few dollars to fix, and what do? Do that right away. Get it done right away. Get it done right away. Take the Word of God right away. Take communion. Take communion. Take it right away. You're supposed to be living on the top, not on the bottom. You're the head and not the tail. You're above and not beneath. Walk in that. See, it's renewing your mind. Isn't that what it's about? So now we've taken that, but now that's, and we know a lot of sickness is what? It's sin. It's sin that the devil injected in the family or something like that, and we've lived by that. You go to the doctor and they say, what's all going on in your family? My family, my parents died very healthy people. Really? Do you have to tell them all that? How'd your parents die? You know what? I really can't remember. Because what they try to do is say, you're just like your mother. You're just like your father. You're going to die at 43 years old from a heart attack. You're going to die. Oh, you're both, your parents had cancer. You will too. And what do? You start what? I start. Oh, that's right. I've got it. I felt it. And I went to the doctor, and the doctor said, yep. Whose report are you going to believe? You'll fight to get that disease and sickness. Now, we don't have to fight because Jesus Christ fought and went to the cross. You're on the top, not on the bottom. You're above, not beneath. Now, the blood was for what? Redeeming you from the curse. Justified you. What did the cup do? Healed you. What did the cup do? Financial, depression, cancer, every evil thing, right? What did the cup do? It redeemed you from the curse. You look at all those curses in Deuteronomy. Whoo-hoo. You're redeemed from everyone. So when any of those curses come on you, you take communion and you cut it off with the Word of God. Cut it off. I am redeemed
from the curse.
I am the righteousness of God
because of Jesus' blood.
I am the head
and not the tail.
I am above
and not beneath.
I have
whatever
I say. Ooh, what are you saying? What are you saying? What are you saying? Is it the Word of God? Or is it saying what the devil says? Because then you're destroyed for lack of knowledge. See, this is for born-again believers to take. Because it's your promise. If you're not born again, you've got old soil, and it won't. No. Do you ever meet somebody that has a lot of world knowledge? A lot of world knowledge. Remember Karl Ball? He had a lot of world knowledge. And he was an agnostic, or was he atheist, maybe both. He started studying that Word of God, and his complete life was turned around. He saw the truth, and the truth set him free. Whew. It's not, and we need that brains for the world, but if you don't have Jesus Christ, if you don't have the blood, how can you be redeemed from sickness and disease and poverty? How can you? Do you see the difference? I'm redeemed. Are you redeemed?
Amen.
You have it in Jesus' name. Let's drink. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Debbie, we've got to have a song that we've got to have, because I'm going to praise and worship God because I get to give myself to Him. This is a big test if you trust God. This is a big test. Would you stand? This is a big test. If you love God, if you really love him, he said, trust me. That's a big test. Americans government, while they're preparing here. Father, in the name of Jesus, we give thanks for the United States and its government. We hold up in front of you men and women who are in the position of authority. We pray and intercede for our President Donald J. Trump, our Vice President, the representatives, the senators, the judges of our land, the police officers, as well as the governors and the mayors, and all who are in authority over us in any way. We pray that the Spirit of the Lord rest upon them. We believe that skillful and godly wisdom has entered into the hearts of our President, and knowledge is pleasant to him. Discretion watches over him, and understanding keeps him and delivers him from the way of evil and from every evil man. Father, we ask that you compass President Donald Trump with men and women who make their hearts and their ears attentive to godly counsel and do that which is right in your sight. I believe you cause them to be men and women of integrity who are obedient concerning us, that we may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and honesty. And we pray that the upright shall dwell in our government, but the men and women upright in our government, that men and women blameless and complete in your sight. Father, Father, shall remain in these positions of authority. This is what I love. But the wicked shall be cut off of our government, and the treacherous shall be rooted out of it. Your word declares that blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Is this United States? In God we trust. That's why God stands with us. We receive your blessing, Father. You are a refuge and stronghold in times of trouble, high cost, destitution, and desperation. So we declare with our mouths that your people dwell safely in this land, and we prosper abundantly. We are more than conquerors through Christ Jesus. It is written in your word, that the heart of the king, Donald J. Trump, his hands are in yours, God. And you turn him any which way you desire, because we pray. We believe that the heart of our leaders are in your hands, and that their decisions are directly, divinely directed of the Lord. We give thanks unto you, for the good news of the gospel is published in our land. The word of the Lord prevails and grows mightily in the hearts and the lives of people. We give thanks for this land and the leaders you have given to us in Jesus' name. Jesus is Lord over the United States. This is awesome. Our president needs our prayers. I don't care if you agree or disagree with him, but I tell you one thing. Moses set the people free. Miriam and Aaron came up against him. It wasn't pretty. It wasn't pretty. You don't come up against God's elect. That's like coming up against God. The same thing, anybody comes up against you in any way, they shouldn't do that, because there is going to be problems, let me tell you. Do you understand?
Yes.
So great is our Lord. Deb, let's do it.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my dream,
yeah,
till I met you. You called my name and I ran. Out of the dark. glorious day. You called my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day. How your mercy has saved my soul. Now your freedom is all that I know.
Listen.
The old made new. Jesus, when I met you, when you called my name, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Story. This is your story. Come on, listen.
I needed rescue. My sin was heavy, but chains break at the way of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the end. Future, my eyes are open, 'cause when you call my name,
shout it!
I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You call my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
Oh, come on. Hey. Hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Oh, you do realize. You realize that when Jesus Christ rose out of hell, that was your day.
Amen.
That's why you have everything he has supplied for you. He supplies half of your needs.
All.
Two-thirds of it.
All
of it.
All.
Well, then rise to the top and let's take it. Let's live like it.
Yeah.
Got it? We've got it, don't we? Father, we thank you. We celebrate this day. We celebrate the rising. We celebrate you every day. We're going to take communion every day, and we celebrate because we give ourselves to you. And Father God, the tithes and offerings, if we don't trust you with this, he said, how can we trust him with anything if we can't trust him by giving ourselves to him, our tithe and offering? How can we trust him in anything? That's what he's saying. He said, if you don't trust me for this, how can you trust me for healing? How can you trust me for health? How can you trust me? You know, that's, wow. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Don't lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. Don't be wise in your own eyes. All the Lord and shun evil. This will bring health to your body and nourishment to your bones. He has already prepared everything. He says, trust me in the least thing. And the least thing should be money in our life. That should be the least. Because now Jesus took the stripe. We see that stripe go on him. And we see We have more than enough money. We see the stripe, we are healed. We see the stripe, we're debt free. We've raised up out of hell. You understand that?
Amen.
Now, you have a wonderful Easter day. I know we're going to go out and have a bite to eat, and then we're going to go home and look for Easter baskets, because Jesus was hid in hell for 3 days and three nights. And when he came up out of there, there was a lot of goodies. And we look at candy and all that like goodies. Right? Well, really, the goodie is what? Healing, prosperity, yeah. Made whole.
Amen.
In every area of our lives. We understand, don't we? And they all said,